Hi, I'm Jennifer Hobson Plattner. I'm your instructor for history this quarter, and we have some history analysis words that we're going to go over today. Now, I want to stress that history analysis can be used in your everyday life. For instance, some of these words can be used in each one of your majors. So we're going to go through them quickly, and the whole idea is for you to take the pretest first. On the history analysis words. And then, maybe you did well, maybe you did poorly, and that's okay. Then you watch this video and then take it again until you get 100% and see how you do. So it's kind of an activity to help you. The first word that we're going to go over is called top-down history. Top-down history, and I have the definition here, is also known as great man history. So if we were looking at George Washington's life only, it is when exceptional historical figures are studied and not that of ordinary people. It is often focusing on the male-dominant society and gives us an unbalanced view of the time because this history is almost always that of the elite class, so just like the richest 2%. So it's not really a good description of history, and that's top-down history. The next word is hierarchy. And some of these I will draw something for. Hierarchy is when power is not distributed equally. So you have the person with power at the top. Maybe it's a lord, maybe it's a king. I'll show you this. And then there might be some people in between, which before there were knights in medieval times. And then you have the lowest class, or peasants, commoners at the bottom. So it kind of has a structure like this. It is not equal. There's a power structure. These people have power, and the other people. These people have power up at the top, and the people at the bottom do not have power. Okay, and that's hierarchy. I'll read the definition. A system of organization where people are ranked one above the other in value, an arrangement or classification of things according to their importance or inclusivity. Okay. There are 25 words that we're going to discuss today. The next one is patriotic history. Now, this word sounds like it's going to be a great word, and really, it's not. It's actually very poor. And the way that I describe it, I am a mom to three boys, and I can ask them to list all my good traits, okay? And if I ask them to list all my good traits, they definitely could, and they're very gracious, and we have a great relationship. And they might say I'm adventurous, or I'm fun, or I take them golfing, or I go outside and play one-on-one with them, and or maybe I do make them feel special because I'm always making them happy birthday signs or celebrating something they do that's wonderful. But if I only look at my good, that's not really an accurate picture of who I am. So that's what patriotic history. It's only looking at the good of a country, and it doesn't need to be just the US, okay? There's a faction in Iraq of people who just want to look at the good of the country and they want to pretend there's nothing bad about it. You could go to France and find some people who just think they want to just teach the history of the good of France and not talk about the problems. So a patriotic history is also referred to as a national history approach. It is an approach to history that teaches only the good parts of a nation's history, leaving out the messy or mistakes that a country and its leaders have made over the course of time, abandoning the truth and only telling part of the nation's past. Now, the problem is when I only tell part of who I am, only the good part, I'm unable to change and grow and fix problems in my life. So to be balanced, I have to, and to see the full picture of who I am, I would have to ask my sons to list everything about me, even the things that aren't, maybe I'm not proud of, or I'm working on, maybe losing my temper or being patient. So this is the whole picture, and this is actually the truth. Now, I'm very patriotic. I love my country, but I want the good and the bad. For instance, we did not treat Cuba very well. They hated us for a long time for very good reasons, if you look into what happened. Because Cuba and the US relations were very close. They were like a sister country to us, and we kind of abandoned them in their time of need. And it's very messy. And when you have imperfect people leading the country, you also have an imperfect nation. And like I said, it's not negative or derogatory or saying I'm going to move to another country because I hate the US. It's just saying let's look at the whole picture and the truth. And that's really why we study history, to try our best to get at the truth. Okay, so patriotic history. All right, the next one is bottom-up history. Bottom-up history is just like it sounds. It is a new way to look at history after the 1960s. In the 1960s, there was something called the cultural turn. And in the cultural turn, historians started looking at things differently. Before, they had only done like great man history or top-down history. Now they were looking at giving history voices to the common person or people that were not in the dominant class, but smaller, more common in smaller groups of people. The definition is a new way to look at to history after the 1960s, giving voices to the ordinary people in history. This new way of looking at the ordinary voices and minority voices, like the racial periphery or women, gave historians a fresh new look to investigate history, and it's really gotten extremely interesting since this time. So, bottom-up history. Agency. Agency means something different in history. The ability and capacity of an individual to act independently and to make their own free choices. Maybe you're living at home, or maybe at one point you lived at home and you were an adult. Some of your parents may have really still treated you kind of like a child and you had no agency. Some of you may have had the ability to live pretty much like adult living at home, and you had the capacity to make independent choices, and that's your agency. And you'll see throughout history that there's lots and lots of groups of people that have no agency. For this instance, slaves, no agency at all, no choices. They were stripped of their power, and it was usurped and taken over by their masters. Okay, so agency is that word. Core and periphery. Core and periphery theory. This actually can be used in many different instances. And the core would be the middle. I'll draw a little picture.
It's
Core.
3 o'clock.
Oops, sorry. It's telling me that it's 3 o'clock. And periphery. Okay, so here's the core and periphery. The core is the power, is where the powerful people are. Whether we're studying England, that would be the mother country. England would be the core periphery. I'm sorry, the core. And then periphery would be their colonies. These would be the people that are considered outcasts, minorities, many times women, or poor. And in the case right now, we could say the core and periphery. The core is maybe England had the power, and the colonies, the 13 colonies, were the periphery. And oftentimes, the core and periphery can switch if there's enough unrest, because the periphery, there's a lot more people there, and if they band together and they come to the core and say, treat us equally and stop abusing us, it can flip. It can flip and switch. So it has to do with power, core, and periphery, and you'll hear us talk about that sometimes and often. It's outcasts, minorities, women, poor, or in this case, it could be a colony because you have the mother country and then you have the subordinate country. So core, periphery. Drew a picture for that. Let me read the exact definition. The core of a society holds the power, and the periphery are considered the outsiders or unacceptable to the mainstream of society and are often exploited by the core. This model can be applied due to superior ideas due to race or religion. This implies a hierarchy and denies equality. All right, the next one is deconstruct. Okay, deconstruct. And this is to analyze by deconstruction, typically to expose its hidden internal assumptions and contradictions, and subverts its apparent significance, to pull apart or reduce in order to reinterpret. Oftentimes, we will look at, when we're deconstructing something, we will look at the situation between England and the colonies, and we will pull it apart, and we'll see really what the issues are really going on. What really is going on is England was trying to treat the colonies as if they were lesser. And the problem is the colonies, the 13 colonies, weren't your an Indian colony or from India or a colony from Africa or another colony. These were Europeans who knew how to use the same words for democracy and for rights and for fighting for equality that the Europeans that were forcing them into oppression. So therefore, if we deconstructed, they were trying to put the Europeans that lived in the 13 colonies into a box that they had put in other colonies into. That is deconstruct. Ethnocentrism. Ethnocentrism. This is the belief of superiority of one's ethnic group. But it can also derive from racial and religious differences. They believe they are better than other individuals based solely on their heritage. So you can have this in the US, in Europe, you can have it in France, you could have it in Iraq. A group of people who think that they're better just because they're Iraqis, or a group of people just because they think they're United States citizens, they think they're better than other people in the world. And this is really a problem in Europe, and that's the next question, or I'm sorry, the next term is Eurocentrism. And you can see right here, the root word is Euro. And centrism just means in the center of, to think of the center of attention. It is a practice of viewing the world through a European perspective with an implied belief, either consciously or subconsciously, you might mean to do it, you might not, in the preeminence of European culture. So it's Europeans who think they're better because they're white, because they're European, they think they're better than everyone else. This is very prevalent throughout the world, really a problem. It was coined in the 1980s, referring to European exceptionalism, a worldview centered on Western civilization as it developed during the height of European colonial empire times. So Eurocentrism. Okay, the next word is binary. Binary means two, like bicycle means two. It involves two choices or conditions of two opposites, alternatives, as in yes or no, on or off. And I'm gonna draw you a picture of what a binary looks like. Okay. Often it's referred to black and white terms, especially if we're talking about, you know, the Indian culture was bad, a lot of people will tell you, and the European culture was good, it was the right way to live, okay? When truly this bad, good, yes, no diagram really isn't the truth. You have to be careful not getting into black and whites. When actually in the Indian culture, women had more rights. They only used what they needed of the land. They didn't abuse the land, and they didn't overuse it or destroy it, like you'll find later on in US history. European culture, women had no rights. You know, greedy capitalism really can really be a terrible thing for a society where the poor go unnoticed or unhelped. And they also, the overuse of land to get as much as you possibly can. And then you find that when there is not really a binary of the two, but it, as you study each one and find the truth, you find that they're more, they meet in the middle, and there's good and bad about both. It's a binary. Okay. The next one is a lot like binary, and it's called polarity, polar opposites. It can be used many times in place of binary. A state in which two ideas, opinions, or beliefs are on completely opposite poles or very different from each other. So this is polarity or polar opposites. And again, you can use the same diagram as, you know, on different ends. Next word is misogyny. And I think we're going to be cut off at this video and I'll have to make another one. That's okay. Misogyny is just like